My name is Jason Eastland, and I am the person responsible for coordinating the fire building and maintaining the fire circle. I went to my first festival when I was 12, and it was a Starwood back when I was in Ohio. In fact, one of the caretakers of the land here, and I ended up there in that space at the same time. And it was pretty much then that I was drawn into the fire circle. I've always been fascinated by fire. I am a self-professed pyromaniac. But I've always had a desire to serve the community as well. So there's definitely a connection there, that it's a place for me to truly serve the community in a way that I can. When festivals started happening and people realized that they wanted to get together in a circle and to drum and to dance, they realized that if it was going to be dark and cold, they needed to have a fire. So a long time back, Dennis Murphy and several other individuals hopped in the back of a Datsun or some ridiculously small vehicle, ran out, cut some wood up, and brought it down. And I believe it was early enough, it was around the time that the movie Ghostbusters came out, and they started singing the Ghostbusters theme to Woodbusters, so that's where the term comes from. So, I mean, as far as wood busting and where it comes from, fires have been, you know, part of civilization for as long as they have been, and there's always been service to the community. Somebody's always been responsible for being the flame keeper. Well, there's two types of fires at the festivals that we actually serve. One is the bonfire, that for Starwood, obviously, and there are the nightly fires, which occur in the roundhouse, where most of us gather for the nightly fires. And there are other places like the midnight ritual spot. Of course, I'm speaking in the context specifically of brushwood. And there are other places like the sacred circle up on the opposite end of the field here. The bonfire itself and the wood for those fires all come from the same place. We have several lumber contractors who actually bring in truckloads of treetops. It's the wood that's left over when they actually do go out and harvest the wood. It's the lumber that's either too twisted or too thin, hollow, rotten, whatever, that they actually can't use to build boards out of. So rather than leave it laying out in the woods to rot, which would actually be bad for the ecosystem, they actually bring it out and they sell it for firewood. Most people buy it, they cut it up, and they split it. We actually just buy it in 20, 30-foot lengths and turn it into bonfires. This one behind me is my 10th Starwood bonfire, and I build a lot of other bonfires for festivals. So the design has evolved greatly. It's gone from being something that I originally came up with to build a safer fire, and there are several other people who have contributed to the design greatly, and it's evolved into the structure you see behind me. In the days of petroleum chemicals and machines that produce fire for us, like lighters and torches and things like that, it's not so hard to keep fire. But back when the only things that created fire were natural circumstances, like lightning or volcanoes, or if they found two rocks they could strike together and actually generate fire with, it was a lot of responsibility. I mean, in order to cook the food, in order to keep warm, in order to keep that which was dangerous in the night away from the tribe or the village, somebody had to keep the fire. So that's always been around. There are lots of ways to serve the fire circle, obviously. The people who are out on the field building the fires are usually people who enjoy the heavy physical labor. People who like to work with tractors and chains and chainsaws and things like that, and put in that physical effort. The people who enjoy doing the fire tending at night are definitely the people who enjoy that play space. I mean, it's definitely the space that, when you're standing out in the middle of the circle there, between the fire and the dancers, bringing the wood in. It's very easy to make it spectacle, but it's not. A lot of what I tell people when they ask, what does it take to be a fire tender, when we're talking about that space specifically, is our job is to maintain. There's a dynamic in the fire circle between the fire, the fire tenders, the dancers, the drummers, the other participants. The people standing in the background aren't spectators. They're still participating in that magical space. Our job as fire tenders is one of the most logistical, obviously. Putting the wood on the fire, keeping the fire going, keeping sparks off the people, things like this. The way that I explain it to them is, if we can do our job without getting in the way, then we're doing our job correctly. Our job is not to stop the flaming log from rolling into the crowd.
as it comes cascading off of the fire, or to pick up the giant logs and stop the dancers in the middle of the ozone screaming log before we put it in there, or to have to back the crowd up by yelling and waving our hands. Our job is to stop those situations from happening at all, because it interrupts the space. You know, we spend all of our lives outside of festival space with people who may not necessarily agree with, you know, with our own concept of what reality is. There's a Native American term for it, and it roughly translates to the bubble world. You know, that which is outside of here, and it's pretty appropriate on a lot of levels. You know, we spend all our lives drawing circles around ourselves. You know, this is the circle around my space. This is my bodily space. This is my emotional space. You know, within this circle, no one may cross. And then we draw another circle around ourselves and our immediate family and loved ones, and we say, this is what I will protect. And then we draw another circle around those that are, you know, our casual friends, and so on and so forth. And all we end up doing is, you know, defining who is and who is not within specific boundaries or circles. To me, the fire circle, as a fire tender, a drummer, a dancer, a singer, a water bearer, a participant, it doesn't matter. It's about letting those boundaries down. It's about walking into the roundhouse and knowing that if I want to pick up a drum, I can. It's appropriate. There isn't a right or wrong, as long as I'm not infringing on somebody else's space or will. It is a collective space. You know, the magic of the fire circle is the connection we have to each other. As far as spiritual preparations, it's important to kind of understand, you know, what ritual is. You know, ritual or magic is the act of manifesting will, obviously. So in that sense, someone who I think is spiritually conscious makes everything ritual or ceremony. Getting up in the morning and taking a shower and brushing your teeth is, it's a purification ceremony. It's cleansing yourself. It's preparing ourselves for the day. There's a Native American prayer, and part of it goes to walk with each step as a prayer upon the mother, which means to do everything with spiritual consciousness. So as far as spiritual intent behind preparing the fire, everything we do is, from cutting the wood to raking out the ozone area around the fire, putting the fire together, filling the water jugs, filling the torches. All of these things are done with a spiritual intent. You know, gratitude for the standing ones or the trees that actually give themselves to us to provide that heat, that light, that space for us to do the magic that we do around the fire. Grooming the area so that it's safe, you know, creating that sacred space. It's casting a circle. There's a focus at a lot of festivals. People gather here to be together, and that's the place where people tend to gather, especially at night. Instead of in small groups, they all come together around the fire, like we have for tens of thousands of years. There are times during fire building when drummers will come down and they'll actually drum during the course of the fire building. And what I think that does, and I've talked to some of the drummers that do it, is it'll establish a connection between the drummers and the fire tenders prior to even lighting the fire. Because once the fire gets going, the fire tender's intent, like I said before, is to stay in the background, to take care of the logistics. Beyond that, there is also kind of setting the tone. It's the call. It's actually letting people know that the fire's going, that it's getting ready to go, or that it's lit. There's dancers down there, and we're calling out the other drummers. So part of it's making the connection between the fire tenders, and I'd say the other part is definitely calling the other drummers in. In my own opinion, the dynamic between the drummer and the fire extends beyond just the drummer and the fire, obviously. There is a dynamic that exists between the fire, the drummers, the dancers, and the other participants, including the fire tenders as well, obviously. I believe that the fire tenders feed the fire, that the fire in turn feeds the drummers and the dancers, and the dancers and the drummers and the fire in turn feed the fire tenders. So the dynamic actually is bilateral all the way around. The drummers, I think, they focus on the fire, obviously. It's a spiritual focus, just like in any ritual. Somebody may use a candle as a focus. It's a place to draw energy from. Also, it's what the dancers dance around as well, and they draw energy from that as well. The difference between first shift, second shift, and third shift,
is it's different for each one of the groups around the fire. For the drummers specifically, first shift is when just about everybody comes down. There are a lot of drummers playing as hard and fast as they generally can. There's a lot of energy expent. I think there is, relative to the other shifts, there is definitely less of a focus. It's more of a, you know, we're down here, we're here, you know, and there's a joy to it. It's just, it's kind of the chaos, you know, in a positive way, in a lot of times. It's the chaos of everybody getting down here and just kind of reveling in the freedom of the fire circle. Second shift, a lot of the people who came out just wanted to have a little bit of fun. They may have gone away. A lot of the people who've been coming around for a long time will come out at this time. It's definitely when some of the more experienced drummers either come out or they're still around. There are, generally during second shift, there are less drummers, but the sound is more rich, it's more focused. The drummers definitely tend to listen to each other a little bit more during that time. And because of that aspect of it, it's the same for the dancers as well. The dancers will have more of a focus during second shift as well, as opposed to first shift. As far as times go, that's incredibly subjective. It depends on the night, it depends on the crowd, it depends on the weather, it depends on the fire. There's a lot of variables there, but first shift usually lasts for a couple hours. When things start to get into, a lot of people call second shift the groove, for all the reasons I just mentioned. That usually lasts a couple hours as well, depending on when the fire started. Around here, Sirius and Starwood, second shift usually starts around 1 or 2 in the morning, if we light around 10 or 11. That lasts generally sometime between 2 and dawn, depending on how many people are in the fire circle, how much energy they've got. Third shift, what happens is you've got people generally who are trying to make it to dawn. There's a closure to going for, you know, the orb, the gold of the sun. A lot of times the drumming will be just as strong, just as focused as it is through third shift as it is in second. Sometimes it's incredibly different. A lot of times you'll get more intricate drumming going on then too. And again, you have less people generally. So it's easier to listen to each other, not just the drummers, but the dancers as well. The red suspenders came in after several individuals were up all night around the fire, basically keeping the rhythm going, keeping the energy going, keeping the fire going. And they were given to them basically for doing that. And it just kind of became the emblem of service to the fire circle. A lot of people have the misconception that having red suspenders means that you're a fire tender, you're a woodbuster. That's not the case at all. Having your red suspenders signifies participation in the fire circle. It's usually a prerequisite that somebody stays up all night with the fire, all the way through till dawn. But it doesn't matter if you're out busting wood or tending the fire, if you're a dancer around the circle, if you're actually serving water, anything, any kind of service to the fire. A lot of people ask me what it takes to be a fire tender. There is a difference to us, and there's definitely a division of labor. There are people who actually help us build the fires, but then don't want to operate in the space, in the fire circle, having to maintain the fire. And then there are people who like to maintain the fire, but don't necessarily like to work out in the field with chainsaws and tractors all day. Absolutely. Every year we get younger people that come out. Of course, we constantly get barraged by boys and girls, you know, that are in the early teens that, you know, they think it's really cool, they see what we do. As far as that goes, in the pagan society, the way I view us is kind of as the warrior caste. You know, that's what we do. You know, we serve the community through physical labor, whereas the elders serve through their experience and guidance. So, of course, we appeal to, you know, to the young crowd like that. You know, what we try to do is keep a careful blend of, you know, how cool it is, you know, for us to be out there and doing things, and explain to them, you know, that the true joy isn't being a spectacle. It's in serving the community. So every year I've got people on crew that are, you know, that are in their late teens. You know, we have them, obviously we have their parents sign waivers. You know, we don't let them do some of the more dangerous things. We let them work into that. And we definitely make a very conscious effort to make it so that it's a kind of a rite of passage
to work from coming within the group to actually becoming a member. It's great to see some of them growing up, obviously. I mean, they really do kind of grow up on you. Of all the things that I hear during the course of the festivals or the year, as far as what's gratifying for me, what's validating for me behind what we're doing, knowing that we're making a difference, it's not great bonfire, wow, that was really cool, you know, you guys did a really good job, or you guys look great out there doing what you're doing. It's the emails or the phone calls I get from the parents in the fall or the winter talking about, you know, what a difference we've made in somebody's life.
My favorite part of wood busting, I really can't say. I love the whole experience. I mean, I come here to work. It's my vacation, but I'm still working, and I love every minute of it. I think my favorite part is tending the fires at night in the roundhouse and just being around all the dancers and all the drumming and pulling the energy off them. When I'm here, I hardly sleep just because I love being around the fire so much that I stay there, and during the day we're working on the fires, building and cleaning the groom house and doing that sort of thing.
You know, somebody said last night, it's not so much going to a class and getting a certificate, it's more of an apprenticeship. So I'd be sort of the journeyman woodbuster at this point, because they let me do stuff, but then on the other hand, we have a lot of elders where you can just stand and go, how did they know that piece of wood was going to do that? And they just know, they're like, oh, that's not going to roll the right way, let's go fix that. And they just know from years of watching how she acts the fire, how she behaves and what she likes and what she doesn't on any given night, they just know. And so I get to look forward to that place of knowing. But I'm not there yet.